Hi guys, welcome back to ThinkView. So, I recently sold my 2019 MacBook Air with the intention to switch to a 2020 MacBook Pro 13 because I just couldn't stand the butterfly keyboard anymore. But then I kinda accidentally spent all of the money. Yeah, you heard that right. So, I suddenly didn't have any MacBook to use nor any money to buy one. So here I was fighting my way back to my old brick, the first laptop that I've ever owned. It was a going to college gift from my mom over 5 years ago. So there I was crawling back to an old dear friend that I've abandoned for better things, but it was always there waiting for me to come back. Without it, I wouldn't have been able to get any work done in the last couple of months. My backpack would have felt so empty when I go to work every morning. So, during this whole sort of surreal experience, I mean, how do you accidentally spend that much money? How do you forget that you don't suddenly have $1,500 to spare? I started to think back to that time when I first got this laptop. The reason why I chose it when there were so many other options. And I remember that the main reason why I bought it was because I thought it was pretty. This is my Dell Inspiron 14, model 7437, a mid-range ultrabook that I got in late 2014 or early 2015. I can't remember that well. It wasn't too long before that Intel's ultrabook trademark started to get popularized. The idea of this thin and light unibody chassis laptop, usually with a simplistic, seamless design without an optical disk drive or even an Ethernet port, wakes up instantly within a couple seconds and lasts at least 6 to 8 hours with Intel's low power chip. I mean, these all sound so familiar now, like every other laptops on the market today. But back when I was looking for a laptop to buy with a budget of around $1,000, it wasn't too easy to find something like this. I remember that most laptops in this price range still looked very plasticky, thick, patchy. Overall, not that pleasing to the eyes, or at least not to my sense of aesthetics. And this one caught my eyes. It was unibody aluminum, had this simplistic, square-cut, clean design with this sick monochromatic silver look. To me, it was a pretty laptop, and I was no reviewer or even tech enthusiast at the time, but a lot of actual reviewers agreed with me on this. Here, slim and stylish, sexy looking beast, attractive mid-range ultrabook. It was considered a good looking laptop. At the time, if you're not spending MacBook kind of money, you're not getting a unibody aluminum chassis. It was very rare. So, 5 years passed in a blink of an eye. This laptop got me through college, countless essays, lectures, journal articles. I mean, I don't even want to think about it now. After I graduated, I switched to a MacBook Air and didn't look back. But what I realized now after going back to this one is that it doesn't look that pretty anymore. And I realized that it's only been 5 years, but our conception of a pretty laptop has changed quite dramatically. I'm going to show you that by comparing this to the Dell XPS 13 9300. Now, I know it's in a different price range, but it's what I consider the beauty standard for ultrabooks in 2020. So I'm going with that one. Now, let's walk through it together. First, what you would instantly realize is the sheer size of this laptop. Here it is, compared to a 16-inch MacBook Pro. It's almost as big as that one, and it only has a 14-inch size display. It's also not super light for today's standard, at 1.8 kilograms, and the reason for the bigger size is these huge bezels. I mean, look at that, just enormous. And the 720p webcam is also very big, and the upper bezel also holds the two built-in microphones. Moving down, look at how tiny the keyboard is. Well, it's not that small. I still type on it quite well. still better than Apple's butterfly keyboard thanks to the decent travel and tactile typing feel, but it looks tiny on this huge base panel. The function keys and arrow keys are too small. The touchpad is also teeny tiny, and I just can't stand how much dead space there is. Look at how much space left at the top and the sides. If everything was just shifted upwards, the keyboard and the touchpad could have been so much bigger. With the touchpad, I like how it feels on the surface though. Nice and smooth. Tracking is not bad either, but it could have done so much better if it had utilized all the space. Another pretty interesting thing is that there are no visible left and right click buttons, just this line to separate and mark them. Cohering to the simple, clean design language, it actually looked very futuristic. Switching to the 9300, you instantly get a very stark contrast. It has a 14.4-inch display, and it's not even two-thirds the size. Open it up, you'd see that this is thanks to the four super thin bezels. The webcam is now shrunken, much, much smaller. The microphones are moved to the top edge, making the internal design look even cleaner. The trend of utilizing every inch of the machine's footprint continues in the base panel. The keyboard is stretched to the edges. There's very little dead space on the top. For that, the keycaps are larger. Function keys and arrow keys are larger. And the touchpad is also larger. You're starting to get the idea, right? The bigger everything is, the better. Well, not the bezels though. You can also see that the touchpad of the 9300 is just one whole thing. No buttons, no markings, nothing but a pad. A design trend that you see in many ultrabooks today. Another change is the inside, as well as the palm rest area of the 9300 is made of carbon fiber. This is a material that's been increasingly used in premium devices today for its lightweight and durability. It's also more resistant to heat and has a great feel to the touch. Now, let's look at the sides. The 9300 is of course much, much thinner. Instead of the boxy design of the Inspiron, the XPS is beveled at the fronts so it looks even thinner. In the 5-year-old machine, the base panel is actually not too thick in comparison, almost just thick enough to hold the USB-A and HDMI ports. But the top panel is much thicker than the 9300's, making the whole machine significantly thicker when it's closed. I don't know why it had to be so thick. And it also goes to show how much the display technology has advanced in the last few years, allowing top panels of laptops to be so thin. I/O is of course another significant change in laptops' design trend. For an even more simplistic, clean look, many ultrabooks today are only down to one sole I/O option, USB Type-C. The Inspiron, made 5-6 years ago, still didn't have any USB-C port, but in turn, it has two USB-A's, an HDMI port and an SD card slot, which you unfortunately don't see a lot in today's ultrabook anymore. The only thing that remains constant is the audio jack, and I hope it's not gonna be axed soon too. One rare thing that I actually don't like about premium ultrabooks today is that the edges are often made very sharp. Too sharp. It looks good, but it scratches and dents way too easily. The MacBooks are even worse than this one. I always end up with some dents on the edges. I really like that the Inspiron has this connecting part between the top and the edges. It doesn't sacrifice the look and significantly reduces scratching. The hinge on the Inspiron only has two joints on the sides, making it quite wobbly and can't be opened by one hand. I mean, that's of course due to weight distribution too. The 9300, like a lot of laptops today, has the 3-module form hinge. Very smooth, very stable, and most importantly, easily one-hand openable. Something that's almost a standard for today's laptop. Now, the outside. Same silver aluminum look. Still the Dell logo in the middle, which you have to imagine it's there on the Inspiron because I'm not taking off my sticker. Both machines have a silver aluminum cover, but the Inspiron has a more textured surface, almost shiny by the look, which makes it less prone to scratching. You can see that I don't have many scratches after 5-6 years of beating the hell out of this machine. There's not much change underneath the machines, except that the speakers of the XPS are moved here, so they don't take up space on the inside. A lot of ultrabooks today also adopt this strategy to save on space, but it very often comes at a sacrifice of sound quality, whereas on the Inspiron, it's on the sides of the machine. That's all for today. Just a fun video to reflect on my laptop using journey that led me to wonder about how the laptop design trend has evolved in the last 5-6 years. I know that this is not comprehensive or even representative because laptops still come in a wide variety of designs and looks, especially depending on its price range and target consumers. But in all of that, there are still wider trends that could be observed, like laptops continuously getting thinner and lighter, bigger touchpads, thinner bezels, fewer I/O options, shallower keyboards, etc. So, how do you think laptops are gonna look like 5 years from now? Comment below your thoughts, and I'm definitely looking forward to reading those because I'm having a hard time imagining myself. In the meantime, stay safe and healthy, and I'll see you in my next videos.